أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد أفضل صلواتك بعدد معلوماتك وبارك وسلم. We will go ahead to talk about a chapter.
Bring that.
And that is the modes and ways of tafsir, how to explain the holy book, how to interpret the holy book. So Mr. Professor reminded me that we missed one thing, and that is that we were talking about means or sources of knowledge, how we are getting knowledge. So as we mentioned before, that means of knowledge are three in number. Number one, that is senses. In Arabic, that is called al-hawas. Al-hawas. And these are five in number. Eyes, we see through. Ears, we hear with. Nose, for smelling. Tongue, for taste. And the whole body for touch. But all these five senses, the animals in general, they do have the same. Animals, they have the eyes, they have the ears, they have the nose, they have the tongue, and they have the touch as well. Got it? So it means that is commonality of human being with animals. So then what is their priority? That is the commonality. So why they are prior to other animals? Yes. So there is a second source or mean of knowledge, and that is called intellect or al-aql. And we talked about this sense in detail. Yes. That where this faculty is. So as we mentioned before, that the fountain is there in the heart, but the faculty is in the head. The faculty, that is, in the head. The sense that is there in the brain, al-aql. And actually this aql, as we mentioned, that based on this aql or intellect, human beings are prior to other animals. Yes. They utilize other animals for their own good. Based on what? Based on intellect. And because of this intellect, they have two things. Number one, priority to other creatures. So we do eat the meat of cow, lamb, and goat, and so on. And not they. We do use the elephant, horse, camel, and all these things for our own good. And they do not use us. They cannot. Got it? So this is intellect. This is number one. And number two, they are bound to obey the orders of the Creator. As they are using the creature, so they are bound to obey the order of the Creator, Allah, the Almighty. Got it? That is based on aql. That is based on aql. And based on aql, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the choice. Animals, they don't have any choice. Animal, they do what they do naturally. They do what they do naturally. Certain things we do naturally. We eat, that's natural requirement. We drink, that's a natural requirement. We go to bathroom, that is natural requirement. Yes. We do fall sick. That's also a type of nature requirement. Got it? Nobody can control that. Can you control your sleeping? That from now onward, I will never sleep for a single minute. If somebody doesn't sleep, so it means something wrong is going on with his internal mechanism. Got it? Got it or not it? Yes. But human being, they have been given the choice, and that is based on aql, that they know they are good and bad. They know they are good and bad, and they have to find out what is good for them and what is bad for them. So based on aql, we do find what is good for us. Based on intellect or intellectual approach, we do find what is good for us and what is bad. But still, aql or intellect, that is not the enough source or mean of knowledge. That is not the enough source and mean of knowledge. Why? This is the question. Is it? The question. So we will proceed to a third source of knowledge, or third mean of knowledge. So why? The answer is, number one, intellect is a creature. Like other creature. You know what I'm saying? Yes. Number two, intellectual creature. Intellectual creature tries to get in touch with the Creator. To get in touch with the Creator. That's a natural requirement. Otherwise, you will never be satisfied in your life. The Hindus are going to their worship place, worshipping idols, but through these idols, they are trying to get in touch with their Creator. Yes? The Sikhs, they are going to their own temple, and they do what they do, the music and musical concert and things like that. Yes? That's their findings, that this is a way to get in touch with the Creator. Got it? The Christians, they are going to their churches. Yes? And through their priests, they are trying to get in touch with Allah. Yes? And in a long run, through Jesus, they are trying to get in touch with Allah. Got it? The Jew, they are doing the same. That is a natural requirement. Now, if you want, and you are trying to get into Oval Office, and to have a meeting with the President Barack Hussein Obama. You know what I'm saying? You want to get in touch with Barack Hussein Obama. You have to find out the ways how to get in touch with. So what you will do? First of all, you will write a letter to the Oval Office. Yes, and you will mention what is the purpose that you are looking for a meeting with President Barack Hussein Obama. Yes, and then they will take the letter through a process. If they will verify, confirm, and allow that, then they will show you the procedure. That was the procedure. On such and such date, such and such time, you will come to Pennsylvania Avenue. You know what I'm saying? Pennsylvania Avenue, such and such number. Yes, on the main gate, you will show this invitation card or this invitation letter to the guard, and then the guard, he will ask you to wait for a while. He will get in touch with someone inside, and when the permission is given, so then the guard will, yes, he will accompany you or give you a company and bring you to a waiting room. You will be, for example, you know what I'm saying? But with big shot, there is a procedure to get in touch. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a big shot only. He is the Creator. He is the Create. So we have to find out ways from him how we will get in touch with you, O Allah, the Almighty. Got it? So for the said purpose, this point number three. For the said purpose, we may find ways and these ways are shown by Allah himself. He is that kind that he has shown us the ways how to get in touch with him. Yes, he has told us about the whole procedure, how to get in touch with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, only to make you to understand that he sent his representatives. He sent the messengers from Adam to Muhammad. Peace be upon all of them. Yes, he sent all his messengers as his representatives. They taught us. They trained us. They gave us the instruction that how you will practice, how you will believe, how will be your daily life, how you will get in touch with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Got it? So you should write that for the said purpose, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his representatives, the prophets and the messengers. They taught human beings. They gave them instructions. They trained them. And those teachings, instructions and training, are transferred from generation to generation. The first generation, the companions of the Holy Prophet, they gave the same to the following generation. And then the same procedure is going on until the day of judgment. Yes, what we are doing? Yes. And as you received your graduation certificate, so that is written there. That is written there in your graduation degree, that Wanusi al-Akh al-Kareem. We request our respected and generous brother, Allah yansana fi adiyat as-saliha, that he may not forget us when he is making any dua and invocation or supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, wa an yarfa'a alam at-tawhid wa sunnah khadiman li kitabihi wa sunnati rasuli, and he may raise the flag of the oneness of Allah and the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he may convey the same message or the same teachings to others. Yes, we got it from our own teachers. You got it here from, then you have to convey the same to others. So that will be going on until the day of judgment. So for the said purpose, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messengers and prophets. They were the teachers, they were the instructors, yes, and they were the trainers. Got it? And they were the practical role model. Number four, they were the practical role model. لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. Allah says, Prophet Ibrahim, he was a perfect role model. Then Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرُ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. That indeed, Prophet Muhammad is a perfect role model for you people. We the Muslim, we do not have any other role model. Our role model is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. That Allah says, that you must follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in word and spirit. Yes, in word and practice, in teaching and training, in teaching and instructions. He is a perfect role model. But for whom? Liman kana yarjullah, one who has the fear of Allah wal yawm al akhir, and the day of resurrection. Wa dhakara Allah kaseera, and the one who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot. So for such like purpose, the only role model will be Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So for the said purpose, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his messengers. And these messengers and prophets, you should write it, these messengers and prophets were given a clean, neat, and transparent nature. They were given clean, neat, and transparent nature. And a specific power was given to them. They were able to receive the message and to carry the message. They were able to receive the message and to carry. We have antennas there. We have telephone antennas there in the corner of our mosque. You have seen it. We have the antennas there. And these antennas are given the shape of a dead palm tree or palm tree. You know what I'm saying? But there are natural palm trees also. So if somebody will say that if you were looking for any rays and connection of what? cellular phone. So a lot of palm trees are there. Why you installed and established these artificial palm trees there? You got it or not it? You got it? No. The connection of a cellular phone needs a specific type of quality. Not only the shape of a palm tree, it could be in any shape. You know what I'm saying? So through that element, they are getting the messages and convey it to the others. Got it or not it? Even though these are artificial, other palm trees are natural. You know what I'm saying? So these messengers and prophets, they were given a specific nature, clean, neat, and transparent nature. They were able to receive the message, and they were able to carry and convey the message. Yes, common layman, he cannot do that. He cannot receive it. He cannot receive it. You have seen the radar, yes, in the airports. You have seen it or not? Radar. There'll be a structure much more bigger and precious than radar somewhere, and it will be moving in the same way. Yes, but it cannot catch the flight. It cannot catch. A specific quality is there in radar, which is taking the flight, that such and such flight of American Airlines or something like that is coming from such and such direction, and then they are giving them the instruction. You know what I'm saying? So a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is receiving the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through that clean and neat nature. You know what I'm saying? And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said regarding Prophet Moses, وَاسْتَنَعْتُكَ لِنَفْسِي, I have manufactured you for myself. You know what I'm saying? What Allah said? You can write this translation. That Allah said to Prophet Moses, وَاسْتَنَعْتُكَ لِنَفْسِي, I have manufactured. Istina mean manufacturing. I have manufactured you for myself. As I give you the example, that all of us, we are driving car, buying it from some dealer somewhere. Yes? Yes or not? But the Mercedes company owner, Mercedes company, when he is manufacturing a car for himself, what type of car that will be? Imagine. You know what I'm saying? So all of us, we are cars manufactured by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Musa was a car manufactured by Allah for himself. We are human created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and brought up. But Musa was a man brought up by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for himself. So through example, you understood what I mean? That the owner of Mercedes, what type of car he will manufacture for himself? What type of human Allah will manufacture for himself? Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, wastanatuka li nafsi, walitusnaga ala ayni. And Allah says, walitusnaga ala ayni, and you may got built up under my supervision. Allah said to Musa, you should write it, and you may get brought up under my supervision. Under my eyes mean? Under my supervision. So when the owner of Mercedes company, he is manufacturing a car and he is taking care of every single part they are fixing there. Just think about every single part. And that was the case of all the messengers. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manufactured them for himself. Got it? So bodily, you should write it. Bodily, they were the strong ever people. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, utitu quwwata arba'ina rajulan minkum, I have been given the power of 40 strong men. How many? 40 strong men. And strong men doesn't mean that he is fat. Strength is not fat. Yes. More probably, a fat man is very weak. Yes. And a slim one? Yes. Why is he looking at you? Fahim said that he jumps strong. You know what I'm saying? So strength is actually the strength of the heart and strength of muscles. Yes? That's why it is said that this is not weapon which fight. This is the man behind the weapon. Yes. This is a golden saying, you should write it. Yusuf, that this is not man who fights. This is not weapon which fights. This is the man behind the weapon. If a coward man, you will give him what? A big weapon. Yes. Yes. The moment he will go to the field, and that is gone. You know what I'm saying? Now you got it? So, bodily strength and muscles of a messenger, exemplary. And that's why every messenger, he stood up all alone in front of the whole world. You should write it. That was the case. That every messenger, he stood up all alone against the world. How many people were there with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he challenged the wrong belief of the people of Peninsula? How many people? No. He was all alone. Yes. He came all the way from the cave of Hira. Yes. And he went to the Mount of Safa. And he said, Ya Sabaha. So people from all around Makkah, they rushed to. That's what's going on. Because this type of call was known to the people of Makkah that somebody is in need of our help. Somebody in need of our, that when somebody cries like this, Ya Sabaha. So every person, he comes out, what's going on? Let's go. Maybe our city has been attacked or something like that. You know what I'm saying? So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did it. And people of Makkah, they rushed to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That Mal is Sadiq al-Amin. What happened to the trustworthy guy? Because Prophet was called as trustworthy guy. That what happened to the trustworthy guy? So all these people, they came around and they sat. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was standing there all alone. Now to speak out the true word against the whole world, that's, but a man can do that. Not me. Yes, you can do that, but I'm not that strong. You know what I'm saying? So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stood up all alone. And he said, Ya ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah. Oh people, say there is no God but only Allah. How many gods were there in every single house? How many idols and statues were sitting there in every single house? For every single purpose, they had their own gods. Yes, this one is for business, and this is for marriage, and that one is for son, and this one is for job, and that one is for this, and that's for disease, and this for sickness, and this for epidemic. And you know what I'm saying? God or not it? 360 big gods were sitting there in the house of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many? 360 statues were there in the house of God, in the house of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, they used to worship them. Got it? So now, challenging this very ancient culture, this very ancient culture. And this culture was introduced in Peninsula by one man. His name was Amr ibn Luhay. Amr, son of Luhay. This is the guy who introduced the worship of idols in Arabian Peninsula. And actually these statues were the statues of some pious people in the past. Statues were not only statues. Statues used to represent someone from the past. The idol used to represent someone in the past. That he was a pious guy, he was a big shot, he was a powerful guy. He was a powerful guy, he has some metaphysical power. So they used to make his statue and worship it, that through his power, we can get in touch with Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was their, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. That's what they said, that we don't worship these idols, but only to take us close to Allah. Only to take us close to Allah. So why you are not dialing the number of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly? Yes, why you are going through these idols? You know what I'm saying? As you know that now those who are worshipping idols are pictures in one way or the other. So these are not statues for no reason. Are idols and pictures for no reason. Yes, it has a history.
that whose statue is this? This is Mahatma Gautam Buddha. So the Buddhist, they go to them. And who is this guy? This is Krishna Maharaj. Whose statue is this? In India, this is Krishna Maharaj. And who is this noble lady? This is Kali Devi. This is what? This is? And that's why in Hinduism, everyone who has a power and he can do or she can do such a thing, common lay people cannot, they made their statue, Pulan Devi. Yes? Pulan Devi, yes. She was a dacoit. But as a lady, she was heading a big gang. She was heading a big gang and she was a powerful lady. So the Hindus, they started making her idol and worshipping her. She's a powerful lady. Yes. And later on, she came all the way from the forest and from the jungles and contested election and she got elected to the assembly. You know what I'm saying? Got it? So all these idols, they have some historical background. Got it? Now, a culture which is going on for centuries, a culture or a custom which is going on for centuries, can you challenge it? And if you will challenge it, you have to face the consequences. Yes, but we stick to your gun. If you are sure that what I am saying, that's the word of Allah, and this is the word of Muhammad. Doesn't matter what's happening to you, that is good for you. That is good, but never compromise. And that was the case of the Messenger of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, all alone in Peninsula, he stood up and he said, there is no God but only Allah. قُلُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Yes, and he was well aware of that what will be the after effects. He was well aware of what will be the reaction of this whole area. But he was not expecting the same reaction from his own kith and kin. He was not expecting that reaction. Yeah, that somebody who is not that close to me, he will show his reaction. All other people will show their reaction, but not my close kith and kin. You know what I'm saying? But unexpectedly. That was not good for a messenger to think like this. This was not good for a messenger to think like this. Because a messenger has to think about Allah alone. Yes, that only he will help me out. Only he will help me out. Nobody else. Even my son, my father, my brother, my cousin, my friend, my relative. No. That is the case of the messenger. Yes, because his belief must be a strong one. So Prophet ﷺ never expressed it, but his thinking was that my kith and kin, they will support me. My close relatives, they will support me. All other people, they will go against me, but not my close relatives, Banu Hashim. And they did it, because that was a culture of that time, that you have to support your own tribe men, doesn't matter whatever he is saying. You know what I'm saying? But unexpectedly, his real uncle, the full brother of his father, whose name is Abu Lahab, whose name is Abu Lahab, and Abu Lahab is the guy who celebrated the birth day of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because as you know, that Prophet's father, he passed away 4 months before his birth. Prophet's father, Abdullah, he passed away 4 months before his birth. Yes. And her mother was pregnant with. And his mother says that I never felt any burden of Muhammad, peace be upon him. She saw in her dream that a light came out of my body. It went to the space and it was getting spreading till it covered the whole world. So in the morning she was a little bit afraid of that. What's the case of this dream? So she went to a foreteller or someone who explained the dreams. So he told her that you will give birth to a baby. He will spread the guidance all over the world. Ya subhanallah, Makkah, which is the center of gravity. Yes, scientifically. That is center of gravity. And that is center of dateline, not Greenwich Mean Time. Dateline is where? In Mecca, under the house of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is actually the center of magnetic line as well. Yes, that where the magnetic light is passing. Under the house of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Got it? The magnetic line is there, scientifically. The dateline is there. Center of gravity is there. Got it? So anyhow, I was referring to the dream of Amina. So he told her that you will deliver a baby who will spread the guidance all over the world to the whole humanity. And it happened. Can you find a small village anywhere all over the world where you cannot find a Muslim? Just tell me. Who says La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Can you find a single minute in 24 hours? A single minute in 24 hours when the azan is not given somewhere in the whole world. Ashhadu Allah ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Got it? I declare that there is no God but only Allah. And I declare that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Subhan. We prayed our Salat al-Isha and we gave azan and we expressed the same word. Yes? At the same time. Yes, Azan-e-Fajr was given there in Middle East. Yes, and at the same time, Azan for Zuhr prayer and Noon prayer was given there in Indonesia. Yes, so this is actually a cycle going on. Yes, start from the far east, coming to the far west, going back. You know what I'm saying? Now here, early in the morning, we'll be saying, Ashhadu Allah, ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. At the same time, somewhere in the world, Azan for Isha is given. Somewhere in the world, Azan for Maghrib is given. Somewhere in the world, Azan for Noon time is given. But the same word is going on all around 24/7 in every single minute. Got it? And that is actually the universality of the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have sent you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a mercy to the whole creature. To the whole creature. So anyhow, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stood up and he said, Qulu la ilaha illallah. Say, there is no God but only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So his real uncle, Abu Lahab, who celebrated his birth when he was born. So a slave girl of Abu Lahab, a slave girl of Abu Lahab, her name was Thuwayba. Nuruddin, her name was Thuwayba. She was the slave girl of Abu Lahab. She was with Amina at the time of the birth of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I think those who visited Mecca, you shown them the birthplace of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, you remember. Lala, you remember? Okay. So Mukhtar remember. Fahim, you remember or not? Yes. Close to the house of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, where there now a library is standing. Yes. Al-Maktabatul Markaziyya. Al-Maktaba? Al-Markaziyya. Actually, that library is actually the house of Abdullah, where Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. When I go there, so for a while I'm looking at that house. That what a house this is. What a house this is. Where the universal messenger, yes, he came to this world. Where the global messenger, the everlasting messenger until the day of judgment. That in every time, billions of people, they do follow him. And they do listen to him. Yes, he was born here in this small house, small in volume, but not small in status. The biggest ever house after the house of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Maktabatul Markaziyya. Got it? So anyhow, Thuwayba, she rushed to Abu Lahab, to her master, and informed him that congratulation, your brother Abdullah, who passed away 4 months ago, he has a son. He has a son. So Abu Lahab became that much happy that he said, you are free. He said to his slave girl, you are
free. And number two, the next day he invited the whole city for a lunch. And at night, he put Christmas light all over Makkah. Even though Islam does not believe in such like celebrations. Islam does not believe in such like celebration. But he was not a Muslim. He was, that was the time of ignorance, time of Jahiliyyah. Yes. But that was his happiness, that he did all that. He did all that. And this Suwaiba, she was the first ever nursing mother of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. She was a noble lady, the first ever nursing mother of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now the same Abu Lahab, when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam conveyed the message, so the same Abu Lahab, look at me, he picked up a rock and he threw it to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he said, "Tabban laka sa'ir al-yawm ala haza jama'atana." May you get perished. You have gathered us together for this purpose. You are taking us away from the religion of our forefathers. You have brought a new thing to this community. You are challenging our culture and custom. Yes. So he threw that rock to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes. And the people dispersed. The people dispersed. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he got into disparity for a while. That I was expecting some reaction. But my closest relative, he is this one. In the whole peninsula, the closest relative of mine, because Prophet ﷺ did not have any brother. Did he? Prophet ﷺ did not have any sister. Did he? Any nephew, any niece. Yes, lot of cousins were there. But the closest ever person to Muhammad ﷺ in relation was this Abu Lahab. Yes, and he was expecting a support from him. So when he did it, so Prophet ﷺ got into, he should have told me, "Okay, Muhammad, just go ahead, I'm with you. Nothing will happen to you. If anything is going to happen to you, I will be with you." You know what I'm saying? But anyhow, and as he made a bad invocation, that may you get perished. So Prophet ﷺ was a little bit upset with these words. Yes. So Jibreel, Archangel Jibreel, came to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, consoled him. That was the time. In such like time, when you get into disparity, you need someone to console you. You need someone to console you, to give you a courage. Nothing will happen. Yes. So Jibreel came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He brought the chapter of Holy Quran, "Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin wa tab." Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin wa tab. Ma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab. Sayasla naran zata lahab. Wa mraatuhu hammalat al hatab. Fi jidiha hablum min masad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that maybe Abu Lahab and his hands get perished. Yes, another meaning. Abu Lahab and his hands are perished. So actually, that was a message given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing will happen to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It will happen to Abu Lahab. Firebag. What? Firebag. That tabbat yada. Allah used the same word used by Abu Lahab. Abu Lahab used, "May you get perished." So Allah says that may he get perished and his hand get perished, which threw a stone to Muhammad, a rock to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the moment Abu Lahab heard of it, he was very much afraid of that. "I don't know what will happen to me." And it happened to him. It happened to him. Yes, he got such a disease. Nowadays you can call it cancer. Yes, he got into cancer. And that cancer happened to his underarms. Yes, and as he had thrown a rock on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his right hand, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word yada, both hands. He used one, but maybe he has picked up with the second one. And then, so Allah says that may his both hands get perished. Yes, and because of that cancer, his both hands fell down.
His both hands? Yes, decomposed from his body. Disconnected from his body. And a bad smell was coming out of his body. Yes, even his sons. And he was the richest man of Makkah. Yes, his sons and his family, they were not coming close to. They have put two Abyssinian slaves to give him services. To give him services. Tabbat yada abi lahabim wa tab. Ma aghna anhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a message to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who gave a tough time to my messenger. Yes, you will see that neither his wealth nor his family will be of any use to him. Got it? Ma aghna anhu, maluhu wa ma kasab. And Allah says, this is not the only punishment in this world. Sayasla naran zata lahab. In the hereafter, we will take him to a blazing fire. Yes. And he is... His wife, she was the arch opponent and enemy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Her name was Ummi Jamil. Her name was Nuruddin Ummi Jamil. She was a very shaitan lady. Ummi Jamil, she was the wife of Abu Lahab and the auntie of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. But when, look, their both houses were standing side by side to each other. When Prophet said, this lady, she was collecting her trash, throwing it in the front yard of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes. Or sometime, she collected all this bed trash, and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was passing by, she used to throw it on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at her and said, what can I do with this lady? What can I do with this lady? And sometime, she used to bring some thorny branches. What? Thorny branches. Yes. And she was not using any slave or servant for that purpose. She used to go to the mountain and cutting the... You know what I'm saying? That this is a matter of reward to cause trouble to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she used to bring a big bunch of thorny branches and putting it in front of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's why Allah said, Wumra'atuhu Nuruddin Hammalat al-Hatab, and his wife Umm Jamil, who is bringing thorny branches, fi jidha hablum min masad, the rope made of dead palm fiber. Dead palm fiber. So she made a rope there from dead palm tree fiber, and she was using that. She was holding the hold of that here, and a big bunch was there on her head. So once she was coming, as Allah mentioned in this surah, in this chapter, Fijiriha Hablum, the same hold will choke her. The same hold will choke her. So both things happened to husband and wife. Yes, husband, he died off, as Allah said, that his both hands will get broken. And his wife, he will get choked with her own rope. And the same thing happened to Ummi Jamil. Got it? So I was referring to that how strong a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. That for a while he got into disparity. But then, ya subhanallah, he gathered together himself. Yes. He gathered himself. And he went straight to the house of Abu Lahab. To the house of his uncle. Abu Lahab was sitting there. His sons were sitting there. His wife was sitting there. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went there. And he said, uncle, why you did it? What's wrong with you? Does it make sense to you? You should have kept quiet if you were not going to accept my message. So he said that, what a crazy message you have brought. What is this? You are going to destroy our community. You are going to destroy our culture, to destroy our custom, our usages, the religion of our forefathers. He said, no, I am trying to build you up. I'm trying to build you up. You people got disconnected from your creator. I want to, yes, give you connection. Said, okay. So what do you want us to say? He said, simple word, la ilaha illallah. There is no God but only Allah. So Abu Lahab said, and then what? And then what? So he said, you will get rid of the slavery of humans. And you will become the slave of your creator only. You will become the slave of your creator only. So Abu Lahab said, oh, and if the black Bilal and Ammar said the same. They were black people and they were slaves. That if the black Bilal and the black Ammar will say the same, so they will have the same status. Prophet Muhammad told him, of course, they will be having the same status with you people. In Islam, there is no white and black, brown and gray, short and tall. And you know what I'm saying? Got it? Western and Eastern, all of them, they are humans. They have humiliated themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing them back to their honor and respect and dignity to say la ilaha illallah. So he said, oh, so it means your message will equalize black Bilal and Ammar to the chief of Makkah, Abu Lahab. You know what I'm saying? He said, now I am sitting in chair and all these black are sitting on dirt. You know what I'm saying? And if I will say the same word and they will say the same, they will be sitting with me on the chair and I will be sitting with them on the dirt. Prophet Muhammad said, yes, that's equality. All of us, we are human. Doesn't make any difference. Somebody is white or somebody is black, and one is rich and the other is poor, and one is from Western side, the other one is from Eastern side. All of them, they are humans. They are equal to each other. So Abu Lahab, he stood up. Yes, in rage. And he said that by Lat and Manat, he mentioned his two gods, that I swear by Lat and Manat, I will oppose this message to the last moment and last minute of my life. I will never accept such a message which will equalize Bilal and Ammar to Abu Lahab. You know what I'm saying? Got it or not it? Because when me and you both said La ilaha illallah, there is no God but only Allah. So I am the slave of Allah and you are the slave of Allah. So we are the slave of the same master. We are equal to each other. We are. This is the message of equality. Ke ek hi sab mein kade ho gaye Mahmood o Ayaz. Lala, na koi banda raha, na koi banda nawaz. That Mahmood, the king, and Ayaz, his slave. Ayaz, his slave, in prayer. They were standing both side by side. So in court of Allah, that is the message, that in the court of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no any master and slave. Got it? Got, these are man-made concepts. These are what? And man-made concepts are? Made concepts, yes. Man-made concepts are? Made concepts. Man-made, M-A-D-E. And made, M-A-D. Man-made concepts are? Made concepts. Crazy concepts. Got it? So anyhow, this is the power, strength, and muscles of a messenger of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he stands alone. And he challenges the whole world. Even though directly he is not challenging, he is giving his message. But the after effect and the bottom line is a challenge. Yes. And they got it as a challenge, that he is challenging our custom. He is challenging our culture. He is challenging the religion of our forefathers. Got it. Yes? Yes or not? Yes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent these prophets and messengers. They never compromised on principles. As you know, and you studied, that they used to come to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what do you want us to do? Please, stop this business. If you want money, tell us how much, how many billion dollars we can give you. You need property or ranch somewhere? Yes. Ranch somewhere in Texas, we can give you. Yes? Got it? You are looking for leadership. We'll give you leadership. We'll give you leadership. We'll make you president. But do not challenge our customs. Do not challenge our culture. Do not challenge. You know what I'm saying? And they said, if you are looking for a very pretty wife, and you know her, yes, and they are not ready to give that lady to you as your wife, so tell us, who is that lady? We'll go there. We'll ask for. Yes, and if you have any psycho problem, so tell us as well. We will arrange a medical board for your treatment. We'll arrange. Yusuf, what? A medical board for your treatment. Prophet ﷺ was listening to, what a crazy people these are. What are they talking about? Prophet told them, I'm not looking for none of these things. I'm looking only for one word. They say, what is that? Just say it. What is that? So he said, La ilaha. Oh, then the same thing. La ilaha illallah. Yes. Because when he told them that, no, I'm looking only for one word. They said, please. What is that? He said, La ilaha illallah. There is no God but only Allah. Crazy. Got it? They use to bring delegations. What? To bring delegations to his other uncle, who was the supporter of Muhammad, even though he did not believe in his message, but he was his supporter, Abu Talib. Who? Abu Talib. And he was standing beside Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam every time. Every time he was standing beside him. Yes. And he was known an elderly person, a respectable person of the peninsula. So the chieftains, they brought a delegation to Abu Talib. And they said that he destroyed our community, he destroyed our culture, he destroyed our custom, he did this and this and this. So please stop him. So Abu Talib said that I cannot do that, let me call him and you should talk to him directly. Yes. So Abu Talib said to Ali that find out where Muhammad is, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Ali radiallahu ta'ala, he came out and he found Prophet Muhammad in the house of Allah. That, oh, the messenger of Allah. Yes, uncle is calling you. Said, okay. So he came, he saw, oh, Abu Jahl is sitting there. Walid ibn Mughira is sitting there. Utbah is sitting there. All these chieftains of their own tribes. You know what I'm saying? House of Lords. Remember? House of Lords, they were sitting there. So Abu Talib said that, Muhammad, these are the elders of your area. Said, I don't know. Said, just listen to them. Said, okay. Just go ahead. So they said the same thing. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, what are you talking about? My words will never get changed. This is not a word which could be compromised. Never, ever. Say la ilaha illallah. Got it? This is a matter of strong muscle. And that courage only a messenger of Allah has. Yes? When people, and especially the chieftains and the big shots of the community, they get together and they will pressurize you and things like that. Yes? So at that time, yes, that no, I'm not going to compromise. That is the case. Say la ilaha illallah. So anyhow, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to Abu Talib, he was thinking that maybe he got pressurized by these people. Maybe he got pressurized by these. So he said that, uncle, you did a lot. I know your situation, that you got sandwiched between me and these people. So I will never feel anything bad of you because you have done a lot. You have supported me a lot everywhere. But if the situation is changed and you cannot, so just feel free and feel relaxed. But I'm not going to compromise. Yes, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he picked up his cloak and put it on his shoulder and said, okay, see you then. So when he was leaving, so Abu Talib called on him, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back. He said, go ahead, give your message. Whatever will be the result, I'll be standing beside you. And that's why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a few times he asked him, uncle, if you can say there is no God but only Allah, la ilaha. He said, no, I'm not going to do that. Even though I believe that you are the messenger of Allah, I believe that there is no God, but I am committed to culture. I'm very much committed to culture, number one, and I am a man of ego. I am a man of ego. So if I will say that, these people will blame me. Oh, what a weak man, what a coward man. What a weak man, what a coward man. He compromised on his culture and custom. You know what I'm saying? So he said, no, I will not believe in your message, even though that I believe from the bottom of my heart that you are the messenger of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ بِأَنَّ دِينَ مُحَمَّدٍ. This is the poetry of Abu Talib. وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ بِأَنَّ دِينَ مُحَمَّدٍ من خير أديان البرية دينا لولا الملامة أو حزار مصبة لوجدتني سمحا بذاك مبينا فاصدع بأمرك لا تصبك غضاضة حتى أوصد في التراب دفينا. He was a very well known poet. Yes, very eloquent poet of Arabia. He said that I know very well that your religion, that's the only religion. Your deen, that's the only deen given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I'm not going to accept it. Why? Because people will blame me for my cowardice or my weakness. They will challenge my ego, and I'm not going to do that. فَاسْدَعْ بِأَمْرِكَ لَا تُثِبْكَ غُزَازَةٌ. So you should convey your message. Nothing will happen to you. حَتَّى أُوَسَّدَ فِي التُّرَابِ دَفِينَا. Till I got buried in my grave. Got it? And Abu Talib did it. Abu Talib, he did it. Since 8 years of age of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was taken care of until 51 years and 9 months of his age. So if you will drop 8 years from 51 or 52, so how much? 46, huh? 43. So 43 years he was giving support to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until his death. So anyhow, that was the power of the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, that's why I was saying that they were given strength, they were given courage, they were given power, they were given muscle, they were given clean and neat nature, transparent heart, receiving message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through that. Receiving message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through. Look, here, what is the voltage of electric? 120 or 220? 110. Just 110. But back home in Pakistan we have? 220. Back home in Pakistan. If you will take any electronics here from, any electronics here from, and you will plug in there in Pakistan, what will happen to the electronics? That is gone. Blip. Yes. That is. You have to put an adapter there because that voltage is very strong in Pakistan, 220. You know what I'm saying? So now, the voltage, a prophet and messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is receiving message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to that voltage. Yes, if you will give that message to any other human being, boom, got it or not it? Now you got it? Only to make you to understand. Yes, and still, what was the case of a messenger when he was receiving a message? When he was receiving a message. So first of all, I will tell you that what wahi or revelation is. Wahi or revelation is. But before that, why it is needed when we have aql, when we have intellect. So through intellect, we go to the space. Do we or not? Yes. We go to the Atlantic and the Pacific and we drill therein. Yes. We put our camera, which is built up on the basis of aql and intellect, and through that camera we find out where the gas and the gasoline is, where the mines are, where the precious stones are, where the copper and gold is. You know what I'm saying? Got it or not? That's based on what? Intellect. So why we do need revelation after intellect? Why? So number one, as we mentioned, that intellect is a creature like all other creature. Intellect is a creature like other creature. So number one, it gets affected. Sometime back, my sight was 6x6. My sight was 6x6. With the passage of time, yes, it is getting weak. So that's why I changed my glasses. Yes. Sometime back, the hearing power, it was strong, for example. And somebody now in old age said, like this, to catch the waves. You know what I'm saying? With the passage of time, the creature is getting weak. It's getting, same is the case of aql. It gets affected. It gets affected. So it means that's not a perfect source. That is not. A scientist who used to send satellite to the space, now he's sitting there in old homes or old age people homes, yes, and he doesn't know how to move or how to speak and how to talk. How are you doing? Oh, yeah. Oh, this is the same scientist? Yes. Who was sending? What happened to him? Creature is getting weak with the passage of time. Otherwise, his intellect was dead, that he was sitting there in satellite. He was sitting there in space. He was sending things to moon and stars. You know what I'm saying? Now, he cannot move on his bed. He doesn't know how to speak. Yes, he doesn't know how to answer. Professor, got it? Alhamdulillah. So number one, it gets affected. That is number one. And number two, a human are different from each other in intellectual approach. An intellectual approach. My approach is not the same as yours is in different fields. So which one we will decide that we will follow him? There is no any criterion. Is there any? Because everybody, he knows that I know a lot than anybody else. That is human weakness. Yes? I know everything. This field, I know it. That field, I know it. If you will talk about anything, yes. Yes. Number three. So humans are different from each other in intellectual approach. It gets affected. Got it? It cannot counter superstitions, intellect, customs which is going on in a community. Intellectual people, they cannot counter it even. Yes, they do follow the customs. Even though sometimes they do think when they are alone and alone, what a stupidity this is. What a crazy practice this is. But in public, he cannot say that. In public, he cannot say that. He cannot counter the customs. Got it? So that's why wahi or revelation is needed. Wahi? A revelation from Allah to a messenger is needed to guide people. Number five. Senses have its own limitation. Senses have its own limitations. My eyes can see, but to a specific limit. Beyond that, it cannot. My ears can hear, but to a specific limitation, not beyond that. My nose can find a smell or fragrance, but to a specific limitation, not beyond that. Even though smells are there, fragrances are there, voices are there, but my ears cannot catch it. Now, what do you think? 4 or 5 is empty now? Big rush is there. But do we hear the sound and the voice of and the noise of cars? Why? Because that is beyond the limits of our hearing power. You know what I'm saying? So as senses have limitation, intellect has limitation as well. Same is the case. With what? Intellect. How you can say that intellect has its own limitation? Why you are going to doctor? Why? You are going to doctor. Because your intellect cannot work in that field. It has a limitation. Yes? Up to Tylenol, your intellect is working. Up to what? To Tylenol, your intellect is working. But beyond Tylenol? Yes, if Tylenol doesn't work, then you have to go to the doctor. That something wrong is going on. So it means that intellects have limits. Your intellect stopped here. The doctor intellect will stop there. Another doctor, he will stop there. But this is a vast word. Got it? So intellect, it has its own limitation. Yes, and a limited source cannot be a perfect source of knowledge. You should write it. A limited source cannot be a perfect source of knowledge. It can be a source of knowledge, but not a perfect source of knowledge. So that's why wahy and revelation is needed. That's why wahy or revelation is needed. What is wahy literally and technically? Yes. So literally, wahy means swift indication. What? Swift indication. Look at me. Yes. Look at me. When I indicated like this, literally it is called wahy. Literally it calls wahy. Swift indication. Look at me. Yes. Now got it? And you got the message. This is called wahy. This is called what? Wahy. Swift indication. Then, this word wahy is used in different meanings. Number one, natural instinct. Something which has been put by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a natural instinct in certain creature. In certain creature. Surah An-Nahl, ayah number 68 and 69. Verse number 68 and 69. وَأَوْحَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحْلِ, and your Lord inspired the honeybee. Your Lord inspired the honeybee. So Archangel Jibril was sent to honeybee, every single honeybee? Never ever. So this is natural instinct that Allah put in their nature. That inspiration mean Allah put in their nature. وَأَوْحَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحْلِ, and your Lord inspired the honeybee. أَنِتَّخِذِي مِنَ الْجِبَالِ بُيُوتًا, take you habitations in the mountains. So وَأَوْحَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحْلِ أَنِتَّخِذِي مِنَ الْجِبَالِ بُيُوتًا, take you habitations in the mountains. وَمِنَ الشَّجَرِ, and in the trees. وَمِمَّا يَعْرِشُونَ, and in what they erect for the said purpose. People are making boxes. People are making boxes for the hives of honeybees. Yes, they keep it. Yes or not? You know what I'm saying? So, do they tie every single honeybee with thread not to run away? How many you will tie? And if you will tie them, so how they will go out and bringing the juice and put it there for honey? Now Allah says, I put it in their nature that when they make you and they erect some boxes for you, you should live there also. That's in their nature. وَمِنْ أَشْجَرِ وَمِمَّا يَعْرِشُونَ ثُمَّ كُلِ, and then eat مِنْ كُلِّ السَّمَرَاتِ, of every type of fruit. And fruit includes flowers. فَسْلُكِ سُبُلَ رَبِّكِ زُلُلَا, and follow the ways of your Lord made easy for you. Now look, you need what? What they call it? Navigation system. Yes. Navigation system in skyline or earthline? That's in skyline? Okay. So you need navigation system to find out where you have to take a right, take a left, stop and things like that. But Allah put in their nature a navigation system. You will take a honeybee 20 miles away from its hive. Just leave it there. Yes. Just put some mark there. Put some mark there, and later on you should come to the hive 20 miles away, you will find the same honeybee there. How it came back? You took her in your car. Yes, and she came all alone walking on foot or flying. So Allah says, I fixed a navigation system they are in. That's natural.
Faslu ke subula rabbike zulula and follow the ways of your Lord made easy for you. Yakhruju min butuniha, there comes from their bellies sharabun, a drink. Mukhtalifun alwanu, of varying colors.
Of varying colors depend on climate, weather, fruit, flowers, types of bees. Got it? So Allah says you will find red honey, you will find black honey, brown honey, this taste, that taste. Yes, and the expertise knows this is from the flower of such and such tree. This is the honey of such and such area. You know, in Turkey, there is one area where there is snow all year long. Snow? And there is specific type of trees grown in that area. Yes, and there are specific type of honey bees who are making honeys there. And that honey is the utmost precious honey all over the world. Only the Arab sheikhs can buy that. Yes, and they say that in that area, only 3,000 kilogram honey is produced every year. How many? 3,000. And 1 kilogram, I don't know for how many $100. Yes?
يَخْرُجُ مِن بُطُونِهَا شَرَابٌ مُخْتَلِفٌ الْأَلْوَانُ with varying colors. فِيهِ شِفَاءٌ لِلنَّاسِ wherein there is healing for men. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَةً لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ verily in this indeed a sign for people who think and understand.
Who think and understand. So now this word wahi, this word which means the revelation. So no any revelation came to the honeybee. It means inspiration naturally. Inspiration naturally. Got it? So this is one meaning of wahi. Furthermore, inshallah tomorrow. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulim Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma rabbana alhamdulillah bil Qur'an zimna zikrna bil Qur'an ma nasina wa alimna min